Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming here. My name is Alex, and I work for a company called DataStax. And I really like Apache Cassandra. And I really like time series. And I have a little bit of a background working with time series a lot. And I'm going to talk about the ways to improve your time series applications with Cassandra. And I will try to bother you just a little bit with Cyanite as an application, but concentrate more on how to use Cassandra to improve your time series apps. And the problem with time series is obviously that it's really hard to make it scalable, because there are only a certain amount of people living on the Earth, a certain amount of items which you can sell in your shop. So everything is kind of limited. The only thing that seems to go on and on forever is time. And that means that every single second or every single period or interval of time, you're getting new data point for whatever you're working with. That means that you are going to have an increasing amount of data all the time. And the Cyanite is just a project which was started several years ago, which was dedicated to fix the problem which Graphite was solving, except for in a scalable way. And when you think of the time series, you have to set up certain expectations or requirements. Okay, what do we expect from the reasonably good application which deals with the time series? Well, first and foremost is, of course, the throughput. And throughput could be roughly divided to several components. One is the incoming data. So every tick that your app makes, for instance, you have a server which is being monitored by some daemon, for instance, collect D, and it collects the data about your CPU, about your memory, and sends it to the Cyanite or to Graphite. And this is the amount of incoming data. The more servers you get, your application has to stay online and has to handle the load that is coming. The second one is aggregates. Obviously, whenever you're aggregating the data, the more aggregates you'd like to have. For instance, you want to have 5 seconds roll-up, minute roll-ups, 15 minutes roll-ups, and so on. This all is going to be adding the load to your server by multiplexing the data you're working with. And of course, if you have a user-facing application, or like there are many clients who want to have an access to the time series stuff you're building, you will deal with an amount of the read queries. And we have to solve the problem of the throughput by making it, well, scalable. And obviously, the first thing that we like to scale easily is the paths or metrics. You can think about it as, okay, you have a server in a certain server farm, which belongs to a certain application, and it has a certain metric. You have a historical data, which we talked about, which grows infinitely, and you have an amount of readers and writers. So these are all the things which we have to take into consideration when we are scaling our app. The other thing you have to think about is whether you'd like to go with aggregated or the raw data, which highly depends on whether you have, like how frequently your servers or your sensors are emitting the data. If it's just like once a second, you may want to store the raw data, but in majority of cases, you'd like to aggregate in order to, well, kind of simplify your life and make the queries in faster in future. That means that whenever you like to query 1 minute or 1 hour of data, you have to fetch less data points than if they were stored for every single second. So, but that also means that for every single aggregate, you have to think in advance and you have to say, okay, I would like to calculate these kinds of things in that manner. And just for example, you could have like certain workers and you would like to, workers metric, and you would like to compute it for the 10-second rollups are going to be stored for 7 days only. The 1 minute rollups are going to be stored for 21 days, and 15 minute rollups are going to be stored for 5 years. So obviously, when the further you go in time, the less granular data you're going to get. But this is probably also what you want to have, because you kind of sacrifice the precision for the space. And in majority of cases, it kind of works out well still. And who has ever used graphite here in the room? Okay, there are quite many people. Who has ever experienced the scaling problems with graphite? Okay, several, I'd say. This is good. And well, for those who don't know what graphite is or does, it stores the numeric and time series data, and if you need it, it renders graphs for this data on demand. And the huge advantage of graphite is that it has a huge ecosystem of things which are working with it very, very well. For instance, like CollectD, Riemann, Nagios, and Logstash, Grafana, Coda Hale Matrix, they have reporters. So you can build an in-house monitoring solution by using, well, graphite and, well, several other apps together with it. And it works fairly well. And the architecture of it consists of the three parts. One of them is the Carbon, which is just receiving the data, and Whisper is a database in file format for storing the time series data. Then Graphite Web is the UI to build the dashboards and represent the graph. So it's a user-facing app or face of the graphite. And there is an app which is called Grafana, which was created also several years ago, and it's gotten increasingly popular, and many people are using it as a default dashboard these days, and many are also happy with it. And the downsides of the graphite are, well, first of all, it was created in an era when the distributed applications were not, well, probably so big in demand, so to say, or the amounts of data that graphite was supposed to handle was much, smaller than we would expect for the average application these days. It also requires plenty of disk seeks in order to retrieve the data because, well, every single aggregate is stored in the file per metric per aggregate. And it was optimized for the space in a way, and the sharding and the replication is done in a rather manual way. When we talked about scaling, we also defined several things that we would like to have in our scalable time series application. And the first and foremost problem is that cluster topology in graphite has to be stored on every single node. The replication is manual, and if you ever want to change the topology of your server by adding the new ones, it's not going to be trivial. Or even replacing the node may be not as easy as you think. And if you want to create a service that is, scaling kind of seamlessly, you use pick-right tools, you can just follow several simple rules, and they are going to be helping you to, well, reach your goal faster. First of all, you have to have your service stateless. So if you have a stateless service and it only talks to the database, other than that, this service could be ran on this machine or any other one. It has only like few data points, which could be lost and forgotten in memory, and the rest of the things are stored in the database, which is distributed, and some other people has done the job for you to make sure that it's available. And the other one is, of course, the automatic shard assignment. Have you ever heard that, well, in Cassandra, like anything about shard assignments? Of course not, because, it does it all for you. And the other thing that you would expect is also that replication is being done somewhere under the hood, because this is a hard thing to implement correctly. And whenever you write a single data point, you expect it to be stored on the several servers in order for you to be able to retrieve it from several ones, or in case of the machine you've written to has failed, you want your data points to still be available from the other ones. The management should be easy because, when you urgently have to add new servers or remove or replace them, this process is already stressful enough, and adding insult to the injury by making this process insanely complicated just makes it all error-prone and makes your application or makes your work much harder. And you want to have an ability to change the topology of your cluster quite easily. And does that all or all these specifications remind you of anything? And it reminds me personally of Cassandra, because everything, single thing that you've heard about just now, Cassandra does fairly well, very well, I would say. And this is why we have chosen Cassandra as a backend for Cyanite. And in the early days, Cyanite had several problems, which I'm going to talk about, which didn't allow us to make the server completely stateless. This day is completely stateless. We use asynchronous I/O on top of Netty. We have a custom scheduler, which helps us to be sure that everything, so everybody is getting enough CPU time, and every task that you have scheduled to be processed on Cyanite is going to be optimally scheduled. We have no whisper files because we use Cassandra, and it's distributed, and it's also horizontally scalable. And the Cyanite is taking over the responsibilities of all the parts of the graphite that I have mentioned. So for instance, we have the carbon compatible listener, which you cannot really tell apart from graphite. We aggregate the data in memory, so you just write anything you want into our carbon compatible listener. We aggregate everything in memory. When the rollup is ready, we flush it to Cassandra. We have the path storage on top of Cassandra with SASI indexes, and we have the path retrieval for the queries, and we have the aggregates, aggregates just in the same way as you have in the graphite. And the Cassandra features that we have been using for the Cyanite are, of course, the metric expiry or time to live, because as you have seen, the specification of the graphite, for instance, demands you to specify how what is the retention period of the metric. And in order to, solve it, obviously, solving it manually is quite complicated. So having the time to live in Cassandra is very helpful for us. We also use user-defined types because they kind of help us to use the format, the tuple-like format for in a very compact way, which is easy for a person to read, easy to extend, easy to, communicate between the people even. And we use the SASI indexes with like queries, which I'm going to talk about just in a second. And we also use the aggregate function, offline data loading for people who would like to migrate from the older graphite cluster so they can load the data without actually going through the whole process of the Cyanide. We use the clustering range queries, which allow us to make fairly quick queries for time series like data, and we use in locking for the partition key, which allows us to fetch all the keys that we require for that particular query at the same time. And we have such a thing as it's called glob index. You can see the video on the screen. This kind of helps you to explore the data or to understand, which metric I would like to present on my dashboard. And as you see, it kind of goes or allows you to choose in the tree-like hierarchy which metric you would like to proceed with. So you pick the top-level metric name, and then you kind of specify every single part. You can also do the wildcarding and everything you can imagine. The problem is, however, this is very difficult, or turned out to be rather difficult to scale and figure out how to use it. First implementation of Cyanide has been doing the globin index in memory. Of course, storing the paths in memory is suboptimal because, first of all, whenever you restart the server, you have to reload everything again, or if you don't persist, you have the data loss. And if you have two instances and accidentally the metric was written one server and has been read from the other one, it won't be available over there. So it creates the multitude of different problems which are related to the same thing. So that data is not available on all the nodes, obviously, and it makes the each node stateful. So in order to make it stateless, we have started using the SASI indexing. Who's heard of SASI indexes which been added recently in Cassandra? So yeah, that's pretty good. So this is the SASI indexing is adding lots of capabilities on top of Cassandra for querying the data in non-trivial ways. One of the things that has been most important for us is of course the wildcard queries, and we have created the table which is storing several things which help us to optimize the retrieval of the data in several cases in the most optimal way. And if we cannot do it the most optimal way, we just fall back to the next level of which is less optimal. And for instance, we have a wildcard query. It's when you just want to have the top level metrics retrieved. In order to do that, you just specify, okay, I would like to have the parent root, so all the segments whose parent is root and the position is one. So this query is super fast because it's, it doesn't require any indexing because it we know where the partition is and we can just retrieve the data from the node. Although whenever you have more complicated queries, such as for instance, you have four stars and then metrics, so you would like to have all permutations of all the servers and applications and everything which have a particular metric. And in order to fulfill this query, we obviously have to use SASI indexes and hit each and every node and retrieve the results only afterwards. And we also have the prefix queries, which are, somewhat optimal, I would say as optimal as the first one with root retrieval. So whenever we know the root or the parent of the particular metric, we just can query its parent and specify the position and resolve the path. And the last one, where the SASI is most useful, is the suffix query. What we do is we trim until the first star or first wildcard, and then we do the SASI index query. As you can see, this word, which helps us to do the full text search on our query storage or on our path storage, and it retrieves us all the metrics which are matching this query, and we will be able to filter them further according to the glob specification on the cyanide side. And we have a fairly simple query engine, which is built, as I already said, on top of the in-partition key locking. What we do is we have three-step engine. I will go through several examples of what graphite queries look like and how Cassandra helps us to solve that problem. So for instance, we start with the inner transformation. Whenever you have the query which looks like, I would like to scale all the metrics which look like A, B, and wildcard. And I would like to scale them by the factor of 10. What is going to happen, you are going to get each and every metric or each and every data point for each and every metric absolutely separately. So you mostly write a multiplication function. So you multiply by 10. So implementing it was rather trivial on top of the query engine. So you can scale this way. So this is an inner transformation. The one level above it is the outer level transformation. So whenever you have something like a derivative, so that means that you have a metric which is like monotonically incrementing, but you would only want to know the difference between the two nearby data points. So what you do is you use the outer transformation, and you just have a state, and you subtract the previous, the current from previous, and you output the result. So if we have the data points of 1, 3, and 6, we correspondingly get an output of 2 and 3. Well, obviously, the first data point gets omitted because we don't know what to start with, right? Because, well, the first data point gets kind of out of nowhere. And there is also the cross series transformation, which means that whenever you have the matrix called ABC1 and ABC2, and you would like to sum them together, you are just going to have, like, if the series ABC1 is 1, 1, 1, and ABC2 is 2, 2, 2, you're going to get 3, 3, and 3. So that kind of closes all the transformations, so inner, outer, and cross-metric transformation. And actually, this all gives you a very vast amount of possibilities. So you can mix and match these things in any order, in any combination that you would like. You can, for instance, scale and sum, take a derivative and sum, or take a derivative, then scale, and then sum some metrics. So whatever you would like to do, we're there for you. And how Cassandra helps us here is that in order to retrieve all the data, we first of all lock by the partition key, and so we always know which node to address for the particular series that we would like to retrieve at the moment, and we have a clustering key, which is our time, and that helps us to do fairly quick scans. So the other thing that we've been using for Cyanite from Cassandra features is the user-defined types. And user-defined types is, as I said, kind of like tuples or whatever you would probably use, something like JSON previously, or maybe like comma-separated or whatever delimited values for. And these days, you can just use the very compact representation of user-defined types. What we use it for is our metric resolution and metric IDs. So this is our partition key. So and this helps us to make the query because we always know which period we would like to query. We find the optimal resolution that we would query because we define it in the aggregate. And then you can specify the metric resolution by giving it the precision. For instance, like 5 seconds and the period, which is a retention period, for instance, 1 day. And we have a path, which is, which I already showed several times, just a metric, a full metric qualified name. And we also store the metric point, which is at the moment just maximum, minimum, sum, and the mean. Whenever we would like to extend it, we just add several fields and be done with it. So it also allows people to run queries and see all these values in a very, well, pretty format, output format. So the other thing we are considering at the moment is Cassandra aggregates. So the Cassandra aggregates can be used in order to reduce amount of chatter of the raw data, so you don't have to transfer the whole raw data from the Cassandra to your application in order to perform the computation itself. So you can do the computation on the Cassandra node and actually never touch the raw data in your app at all. It allows you to define your queries in a very flexible way because you pretty much can use Java as a language of choice, and you just write the query and can run it, or it will be ran whenever you need it. And I made a simple example, or simplest example, of implementing the sum, which is pretty much taking the time series, which are aligned by the timestamp, and it's summing the time series from the specified by the in query. I will show it just in a second. So right over here, so we specify in the in query the path and resolution and the period, and we specify the time range we would like to query, and it's going to, well, retrieve these two paths, because two paths are aligned by the timestamp. It's going to aggregate it and return us the summed results. So you pretty much can implement the whole amount, or all the aggregates I've been mentioning previously in Cassandra aggregates. And how you would scale the time series application, or what helps us to scale Cyanite is, well, first of all, I would highly recommend you to take a look at date tier compaction strategy. And of course, try to keep your application stateless. For the high load, we have experienced that in our case, we have been splitting the readers and writers because we have rather interesting payloads that are coming, because we're also multiplexing it by the amounts of aggregates which we would like to compute. So in order to make both writes and reads more predictable, we are suggesting users to split the loads like the user-facing writes and the user-facing reads and the application-facing writes. You can easily load balance Cyanite via HA proxy. So this is probably as simple as it gets. And in several cases, we've also seen major performance improvements by collocating Cyanite and Cassandra. Given that neither I/O nor neither network I/O nor local I/O is saturated, so everybody or every application should have enough space or room to wiggle a little. What is coming soon in Cyanide, or what we've been looking on and trying to make the application better, is adding more opportunities, because we at the moment only give from the sensible things like minimum, maximum, and mean. We would like to add the p-square histograms. This is one of the ways to create the streaming histograms, compute them on the fly, which is also not going to blow up the memory usage or consumption. We wanted to add the t-digest quantiles. If you're interested in how to reduce the amount of data for your time series application, I highly recommend to take a look at these two papers. The third one is Gorilla Compression, which was released several years ago by the Facebook. This is also quite interesting and innovative method to make the time series data in particular extremely compact, so you can get a major improvement, like tenfold. And of course, the Cassandra aggregates are not completely spelled out in Cyanide just yet, so we're still working on it. We would like to implement the custom glob indexes in order to optimize even further for the queries that we have at hand. And we would like to improve our scheduler, make it more flexible and dynamic. And other things are Kafka ingester, implementing the statsd protocol, extending the capabilities for aggregation, providing the standalone in-memory Cyanide, and maybe adding some dynamic thresholds for monitoring, which all you could use as ideas for your time series application. That was it. Thank you very much for your attention, and we still have just a little bit of time for a question, roughly 5 minutes.
Can you give us some idea of the performance capabilities of Cyanide, for instance? You know, how many data points can you handle, let's say, per second on a...
How many data points you can handle per second highly depends on which kind of hardware you're going to be using. But it also
depends on the data. So let's say I have a full market feed that I get from all the major exchanges, and I get every event in the equities and futures market, that's billions per day. That's typically on the order of 30 billion per day. Can you handle that?
Usually, I don't speak in billions per day. We usually speak in events per second. And we get like several hundred thousand events per second per node. So this is what we are usually talking when we talk to the people who have the installations. I would recommend splitting the read and write payloads. And we had an installation of, well, just several servers, which was handling, there is a ticket opened by the person who actually did the benchmark on their own cluster. So you can, or either write me an email and I will send you the particular data points. Yeah, okay. So, but this is kind of a ballpark.
So you mentioned something about Kafka and gestures for future. What would you need that?
The thing is that, we've been very happy with the, well, first of all, if you use UDP, it's unreliable transport. And if you use TCP, it's just too much hand waving you have to do in between. And from my personal experience, Kafka was kind of the most optimal or easy thing for time series like data to fire and forget. So this is why we have Kafka ingester in plans, and this is why I kind of recommend using Kafka for time series like data. Yeah, so we would mostly, instead of the carbon listener, we would just listen to the Kafka. And any user will be able to just pump their data into the Kafka, and we would be streaming it straight from there, which will also allow us, for instance, easier server replacement. For instance, if Cyanite server should be restarted for whatever reason, you won't have any data loss because we will pick up from wherever we left off.
In that situation, can't you do some aggregation
right on Kafka itself? With streams, we definitely can do. But to be honest, I did not look at it precise or that deep yet. But as you mentioned it, I think that yes, we definitely can do. Whether we will or not, we will have to look and measure, obviously. But you're right. Probably if you do it in your application, it would be a good idea. Yes, please?
I had a question if you're thinking about the flat namespace style of Graphite, the metric name.
Yes.
Versus what a lot of newer projects like Mm-hmm. Label tags basically on your metrics.
Okay.
We use Cyanite at my last company pretty heavily and eventually just started blowing out the concept of an index. I think there was still a requirement on Elasticsearch.
Yeah. 1 year ago, index was the weakest point of Cyanite. It was horrible. Okay. So I'm saying that out loud. And yeah, it was very, very, very bad. We improved it, and the largest installations that we are aware of are happy with it at the moment. So,
but it's still flat style names.
This is flat style names. If you could fire up us, first of all, we would like to remain compatible with Graphite, at least at the moment. But if you could explain in an issue or in an email, and if you're interested, we could continue that conversation. Yes, please. Oh, yeah, you have a microphone, obviously.
You mentioned gorilla compression. It's very promising. Is it better to push it into Cassandra instead of
the problem with pushing it to Cassandra that it's impossible to push it into Cassandra on the right path. So you won't be able to write gorilla compressed blob because, there is no concept of online aggregation within Cassandra just yet. So if we'd have something like a materialized view, a temporary buffer, probably it would be possible. But at the moment, pushing it for the right path on Cassandra level won't be possible at all.
How about a compression? Do you have compression for the stat table? SS table, I mean, they have a compression.
Yeah, there is a compression for SS table, of course, yes.
Is that one is using aggregator compression, is it?
No, not at all.
I'm
told that I have to put it to the end. Unfortunately not, it's not, the aggregator compressed is not, compression is not used. It's, there is, there are, like, I think it's pluggable backend for compression, but it's like has nothing to do with Gorilla. Gorilla is only for time series.
Okay. So you don't know they have plan to do it? No.
Excuse me?
You don't know they have plan or do
as things? I have not seen a ticket on the open source Cassandra, no.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you very much.